Would you stand with us, please, as we let God arise? Hear the holy voice of God arise. Watch the waters part before us now. Come and see what He has done for us. Tell the world of His great love. Our God is a God who saves. Well, our God is a God who saves. Let God arise. Let God arise. Our God reigns now and forever. Well, He reigns now and forever. And His enemies will run for sure. And the church will stand, she will endure. The keys of life, our Lord. The past, no sting, no final word. Our God is a God who saves. Well, our God is a God who saves. Let God arise. Let God arise. Our God reigns now and forever. Well, He reigns now and forever. Let God arise. Well, let God arise. Our God reigns now and forever. Well, He reigns now and forever. Well, our God is a God who saves. Well, our God is a God who saves. Well, our God is a God who saves. Well, our God is a God who saves.
Yeah!
Let God arise. Let God arise. Our God reigns now. Well, He reigns now and forever. Let God arise. Well, let God arise. Our God reigns now and forever. Well, He reigns now and forever. Yeah. Father, we thank You. You don't need our permission to arise, Father God, but we allow in our hearts, Father, we want You to arise in our hearts today, Father God. We want You to arise in this very church. We want You to arise in the church, in the body. We want You to arise in our nation, in our world, Father God. Arise, God, in Jesus' name, amen.
You may be seated in His presence. This very morning, I want to put Danny and Lydia Runkle in the doghouse. Come on up here, guys. No, no, you don't have time to sit down. Come on, come on, come on. Now, I usually just say, you know, what can we pray for you about? But I know you guys got some stuff going on that I already know God been praying for you, right? One of those things was some work-related issues and things happening for you at work. I won't go into a lot of details, but we've been praying for you. Is there anything you would like us to pray for you about that specifically, or anything you want to share with us about that specifically? Okay.
I interviewed for a promotion, my first ever at the college. Don't know if I'm going to get it yet, but the questions were geared specifically to what I was already doing, so that's a good sign.
Okay.
So I just want to pray that it's God's will, because obviously if it's if you force it and it's not his will, I'll be miserable. So
that's
I don't want to do that.
Yes.
All right. So I want God's will on that. Amen. Plus health issues with different members of the family that are all getting way up there. Well, you're not getting way up there, but yeah.
other family members older
than you.
That's
why I like her. That's why I like her. You're not really.
He raised his hand when I said getting way up there. No, and Danny's having, you know, stuff. So
we'll definitely pray for that, because I think you want God's will for you in your life,
yes.
whether it's a promotion or a position within a church, or within the college, or whether it's not.
Right.
You would want God's will, and I would covet God's
yes.
people's prayers around it. So I think that's what she's asking, that we might pray for that. Whatever it comes out, you just say it's God's will.
Right. And also the children's ministry
The children's ministry. Yeah,
yes,
we're going to be praying a lot for that.
We're,
yeah,
we're looking at VBS maybe.
Yes.
So we're going to see if we can bring some in.
Yes,
so.
Yes. And we have some software stuff you're going to need to be on.
I know. I got to do that.
All that kind of stuff too. Yes. Yeah, you're going to be overwhelmed here pretty soon.
I'm just really.
If the Lord gives. Also, Danny, I know that you're working on an internet radio.
I am, yeah.
All right. Why don't you tell us about that and how we can listen in.
Well,
and when we can.
Yes, I'd like you to pray for that. It's you can remember the name, because most of you know the group Stonecastle, and we're calling it Stonecastle Radio, and it is internet radio on Live 365, and we'll be bringing out some details later. We'll be all over different places on Facebook and website as far as details and when we're going to actually do the launch. It's on now, but we're not officially launched because I'm not talking. Just still loading songs and whatnot, but pray for that. And what it is really is an alternative, because as Christians, and this brings me another thing I'd like us to pray for, and that's the body of Christ, the church, not just ours, but the church. Because, and start with me, you know, I'm not pointing fingers at anybody, I'm pointing right at me first. God has shown me that there's a lot of worldliness in the church, in people, and just as we're getting too comfortable sometimes with the world, and especially in entertainment and other things like that. So what this is kind of like, I would call it Way FM lyrics to Gator and Sunny 105 music, kind of like that, okay? Where the music, if you're feeling a little nostalgic musically, I'm not going to play secular songs, okay? There's some that are Christian-oriented that are from people like that, but, you know, as Christians, we need to be careful what we let into our eyes and ears and stuff. So this gives you an alternative for that. Pray for that. Also, my health is, I'm having some few little issues here and there. I don't want to get into details with that. Pray for our kids and our young people here, our kids personally at home or not at home, and the grandkids and the new great-granddaughter. And for those who didn't know, we are great-grandparents now. So there's that. And I am getting up there, apparently. So anyway, but I love you for saying that. And that's it.
Okay, great.
Whatever.
Yeah.
What we're doing this thing.
All right, let's pray. Father, I just thank you. I thank you for this couple, Father. They've been here over a decade. Father, serving you, honoring you, blessing you, Father, in this place. And so, Father, I would pray your continued blessing upon them, Father, as they continue to seek your will in their lives. I uphold Lydia especially, Father, even at this particular moment, even seeking new position, maybe within the college, Father. I pray your favor upon her. And Father, I pray that whatever your will is done, she is comfortable with that. Whether that's a new position or not, she's comfortable in the realization that your will has been accomplished. Father, I thank you that she trusts in her fellowship of believers that are around her to uphold her and come beside her and pray that your will would be done in her life concerning this matter. Father, I pray also for Danny, Father. I pray that Stonecastle Band, Father, radio, internet radio, Father, I pray that there's launch dates and all the things that are happening there and uploading music and all the things that need to take place, Father, I pray that you keep him on track, keep him focused upon you, keep him, Father, in that place where he honors you and serves you and loves you and glorifies you and sings to you and rocks out to you. And Father, just I pray, Father, blessings upon him and the things that he is doing to minister on for you and on your behalf. And Father, I pray you bind them together, Father, as a husband and a wife, Father, that their marriage serves as a living testimony to their family, to those that are around them, to their children and grandchildren, great-grandchildren, Father, that they would come to a place of understanding, Father, that what great things can be accomplished when a couple is united in the presence and the Holy Spirit of God. May their lives and their marriage serve as a testimony of what God can do. I pray for their physical well-being, Father. Father, keep them healthy. Keep them in sound of mind. Keep them serving you. Father, keep them in a place where they are feeling good physically within their bodies, Father, that they are able to continue to serve you and honor you and be at the point and out front for you. I thank you so very much, Father, for who they are to me personally, Father, and what they have meant to your church. And so, Father, we come before you with thanksgiving, with praise, and with adoration as we uphold our brother and sister, Danny and Lydia, before you. In the name of your Son, we pray. Amen. Amen. God bless you guys. Keep praying for them, will you? Keep dogging them all week long. Just keep dogging them. All right. We are a house of prayer. And hey, by the way, check this out.
By our love.
they'll know we are Christians by our love. We will work with each other. We will work side by side. We will work with each other. Side by side, and we'll guard each man's dignity and save each man's pride. And they'll know we are Christians by our love, by our love. Yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love.
Your face, oh God.
have thine own way, Lord. Have thine own way. Thou art the potter. I am the clay. Mold me and make me after thy will. Today, whiter than snow, Lord, wash me just now, as in thy presence, humbly I bow. Have thine own way, Lord, have thine own way. Verse number one. Have thine own way, Lord. Have thine own way. Thou art the potter. I am the clay. Mold me and make me after thy will. Father, this day and this service, have your own way, Lord. Have your own way with us. Have your own way with Pastor Stan as he brings the message, Father, that he would speak your words. Father, we thank you. We thank you for this day. We thank you for everything you've done for us. Lord, we once again give our lives to you. Place them in your hands with full trust. In Jesus' name, amen.
Father, in this place, may we rest in your stillness. Don't spend enough time in your presence to just be still. Be still and know that I am God. Within your presence in this place, minister into our hearts and into our minds. Challenge the very depths of our souls. Make straight our thinking. Father, may our desire be to rest in you. Refresh us, Lord, and empower us that we might serve you and serve you well in the name of your Son. Amen. You may be seated in his presence.
We need a guide. We need the Word of God to light our path. Scripture is powerful, and it is truth. It is breathed by God Himself. It is sharper than any two-edged sword and pierces deep into the soul. We need His Word to train us and to teach us how to live righteously. In His Word, we find life. Heaven and earth will pass away, but the Word of God will stand forever. Trust in His eternal Word, and He will guide your path.
Good morning, everyone. Mm-hmm. Today's scripture reading is in 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse 3. Here is a trustworthy saying: whoever aspires to be an overseer desires a noble task. Now the overseer is to be above reproach, faithful to his wife, temperate, self-controlled, respectable, hospitable, able to teach, not given to drunkenness, not violent but gentle, not quarrelsome, not a lover of money. He must manage his own family well and see that his children obey him, and he must do so in a manner worthy of full respect. If anyone does not know how to manage his own family, how can he take care of God's church? He must not be a recent convert, or he may become conceited and fall under the same judgment as the devil. He must also have a good reputation with outsiders so that he will not fall into disgrace and into the devil's trap. In the same way, deacons are to be worthy of respect, sincere, not indulging in much wine, and not pursuing dishonest gain. They must keep hold of the deep truths of the faith with a clear conscience. They must first be tested, and then if there is nothing against them, let them serve as deacons. In the same way, the women are to be worthy of respect, not malicious talkers, but temperate and trustworthy in everything. A deacon must be faithful to his wife and must manage his children and his household well. Those who have served well gain an excellent standing and great assurance in their faith in Christ Jesus. Reasons for Paul's instruction. Although I hope to come to you soon, I am writing you these instructions so that if I am delayed, you will know how people ought to conduct themselves in God's household, which is the church of the living God, the pillar and foundation of the truth. Beyond all question, the mystery from which godliness springs is great. He appeared in the flesh, was vindicated by the Spirit, was seen by angels, was preached among the nations, was believed on in the world, was taken up in glory. God bless this reading.
Sua, everybody, thank you so much. And recently engaged, if you don't know, Bob Mashani back there, very nice, very nice. Pick on him a little bit, dog on him, love on him a little bit. 1 Timothy, this particular chapter, is all about leadership. So there's your first slide if you want to throw that up there for me. Leadership. It's all about leadership. So much has been written about the subject of leadership, and truthfully, you won't find any greater handbook on leadership than God's Word. John Maxwell would say it this way: everything rises with or falls with leadership. I have found that when things are good, God gets all the glory. And when things are bad, the pastor gets all the blame. Because the essence of leadership, responsibility. Assuming responsibility. Whoever aspires to be an overseer desires a noble task. You can look into God's Word and find great leaders. You can look into God's Word and find bad leaders. Godly leaders, wicked leaders. Strong leaders, failed leaders. servant leaders. God is really not shy about sharing bad leadership. As much as we often praise and, you know, thank the Lord for all the good example, he's not shy about sharing what is bad, sometimes even within the good leadership. The good news and the bad news about church is that, well, the good news is we're like a family. And the bad news is what? We're like a family. Without even trying, we model our lives. Without even trying, we model our lives and we model our values. Parents in particular demonstrate to their children what should be considered valuable and important. And Timothy is one of those that had a good, godly, influential family. His grandmother Lois, his mother Eunice, both Christians, raising their son Timothy, and grandson Timothy. Timothy, listen to the wording, is the first, second generation Christian mentioned in the Bible. Do you understand that?
Yes.
Okay. Timothy was a protege of the Apostle Paul, and he became the pastor of the church in Ephesus. And that's where Paul sends him, back to Ephesus. Now, as a minister, he was a traveling companion with Paul on three of his missionary journeys. So Timothy's got some experience in, you know, preaching in churches and being evangelical. Timothy has seen much, experienced all sorts of pressures, all sorts of conflicts, all sorts of troubles and challenges. Now, Paul writes these personal letters to Timothy to encourage him, to serve as a foundation for him. And Paul speaks much like a father to a son, a spiritual father to a spiritual son. And he warns him in this particular chapter and throughout several other places of false teachings, the importance of prayer, and the significance of corporate worship, everyone being together and honoring God. He gives instructions on pastoral care for the young, for the old. And of course, there's a discussion on church leadership and those that he would appoint, those that he would bring alongside him to minister. Our scripture gives very clear instructions on some of the criteria for the positions. Now remember, if you will, Timothy's going to Ephesus because Ephesus is in a bad way. They've wandered some way from the teachings of Paul, the foundational teaching. They've allowed some of the world to creep in. They've allowed some of the Greek philosophy and mythology to creep in. And so Paul sends Timothy, go straighten them out. He has to put things back in order. And just as every secular business needs strong leadership, the nonprofit organizational structure of God's church needs strong leadership. Far too often, however, we would treat God's work much like a secular business. The nonprofit organizational structure upon which we sit lends itself to many secular guidelines. We can build awesome organizations. We know all the formulas about what's required and how to establish a 501(c) as an example and the structure that needs to take place. We know about fundraising. We catch phrases that need to be marketed. We're very aware of the tax-exempt statuses that go with churches and all the marketing techniques and even some of the technology that needs to be upgraded and updated so that we can operate very much like a secular business. But is that spiritual leadership? Is that spiritual leadership? Do we need spiritual CFOs? Do we need spiritual COOs, operating officers? See, my definition of spiritual leadership is very different than organizational structure. It's not that we don't need to understand organizational structure. We absolutely need to understand organizational restructure. But spiritual leadership, while inclusive of that, is broader and much more than that. Or it's inclusive of something or someone else. My definition of spiritual leadership is much more functional. See, spiritual leadership is not me trying to get you to do something that makes this nonprofit organizational structure wealthy and well-organized. That's not spiritual leadership. Spiritual leadership is, what is God doing in your life? How do we make that happen? What is God doing in your life? How can we walk alongside with you? What is God speaking to you about? Where is God leading you that we might walk with you, encourage you? So that's spiritual leadership. Perhaps the Lord's leading you to be an overseer, a pastor. Perhaps the Lord's leading you to be an elder or a deacon or a trustee or help in children's church or be a Sunday school teacher. See, what is the Lord doing in your life? See, the church is not a building. It's you. See, now, if a building helps us grow, let's have a building. If a building helps us in our outreach, in corporate worship, let's have a building. If it helps us in gathering together for prayer times and places where we can fellowship and study the Bible, then let's have a building. But the church is not the building. The size and the structure, its architecture, is not a determining factor of whether it is a spiritual success. How many churches have I seen over the last several decades fail because they got a building? They're gathering together as a small fellowship of believers, and they're so excited about the Lord, and they're excited about learning about God, and they gather people around them, and they sing, and they praise, and they say, you know what? We're getting big. We need to have a building. And so they go, and they purchase a building, and all the leadership isn't thinking about baptisms and outreach. They start thinking about insurance payments and water problems, and the toilet is flooded. And the dynamic of what spiritual leadership is that brought them such wonderful results all shifted and changed with responsibility. Did they lose their first love? If you lost your first love, laying it all out before the Lord, lead me where you will. Paul doesn't address anything like that at all. He doesn't say, you know, Timothy, look for a good acre of land, and you need to have a storefront. Make sure that there's plenty of parking and good signage. You should always buy, never rent. There's not any of that discussion. Paul doesn't describe the color of the pews. Paul talks to Timothy about leadership, spiritual leadership. And as you grow in your faith, Timothy, look for these traits in others that may serve with you in the kingdom of God. One of the primary things that every church must have is godly leadership. Would you agree with that? Say amen.
Amen.
But what does godly leadership look like? My mission statement's been, I've been walking this for a long time, to encourage others to make an eternal impact and be a trusted advisor. That's my whole mission statement. To encourage others to make an eternal impact and to be a trusted advisor. God has me doing that as a pastor. My mission statement wouldn't necessarily change if I became a ditch digger. What is leadership in the spiritual realm? Leadership in an organization is much different than the leadership in a movement. You understand what I'm saying? The president of a Christian college, much different than the pastor of a church. Both in Christian leadership. But their function will be very, very different. Hebrews would write it this way, and I like this. Remember your leaders, who spoke the word of God to you. Consider the outcome of their way of life and imitate their faith. Spiritual leadership is spiritual maturity that others can examine and follow. I used to say a long time ago, you don't want to follow me. You know, oh man, you don't want to be like me at all. No, I'm broke. I'm a sinner. You don't want to be anything like me. I don't know much. But every time I would say that, it brought me way back to those dark places in my own life when I was self-degrading. And I realized, I'm not those things. That's not what the Bible calls me. That's not what Jesus says about me. That's not who I am. That's who I was. I'm healed. I'm cleansed. I'm walking in the power of the Holy Spirit of God. I'm an heir of the throne. I'm a child of the Most High God. I have boldness and I have strength and I have convictions in my faith and I am an overcomer. I am more than a conqueror in His name. That's who I am. You should want to follow me. You should want to imitate me. Now, I don't say that as something that's prideful. I say that saying, I found something. I found something. Man, and you need to know about it. It changed my life. He changed my life. His name is Jesus. Ever heard of him? You want to know about him? I can tell you all kinds of things about him. I can tell you all the great things he's done for me in my life. He changed my life. He changed how I think about money. He changed how I think about life and afterlife. He changed how I think about death. He changed how I think about relationships. He changed how I thought about marriage. He changed my way of being. He changed how I respond to a world that does not know him and rejects him. He changed the way in which I relate to other fellow believers. And when you find him, he'll change your life too. He will bless you. He will honor you. He will guide you. He will lead you. Never forsake you, but always uphold you. I believe that Hebrews definition because it demonstrates that true leadership begins from within. As the believer grows and matures, and his walk with Christ begins from within. If you desire to be an overseer, it's a noble task. The overseer is to be above reproach, faithful to his wife, temperate, self-controlled, respectable, hospitable, able to teach, not given to drunkenness, not violent, but gentle, and not quarrelsome, and not a lover of money. He must manage his own family well and see that his children obey him. He must do so in a manner worthy of full respect. He must not be a recent convert. He must also have a good reputation with outside. That's a pretty strong list. It doesn't say 6 foot tall, blue eyes, handsome, drives a Mercedes. Nothing about physical attributes at all. Much like Proverbs would describe a noble wife, no physical characteristics, but characteristics. There's your first one. It's all about character. Character in your private life and character in your public life. Leadership involves others. For those that like to take notes, leadership involves others. Absolutely it does. And this is true whether you're in a secular business or whether you're in a nonprofit organizational structural church. Leadership involves others. This is why character is so important. See, if you're leading, it's probably a pretty good idea that every once in a while you might take a look behind you and see if anybody's following you. Because if you're saying I'm leading, but nobody's following, you're just out for a walk. Spiritual maturity begins from within. But it evidences itself externally. It begins from within, but it exhibits itself and evidences itself and displays itself externally. There is a public life to your character. There's a private life to your character. And many would say there's a secret life to your character that only you know about. And it really just makes sense that in the scriptures, the first ones to observe your life would be those that are closest to you, probably family. Good spiritual leadership always begins in the home. A believer's spiritual maturity and spirit-filled life will first be noticed by his family, those that are closest to him. You want to know if I'm a person of good character? Don't ask me. Ask my wife. You want to know if I'm a person of good character? Don't ask me. Ask my brothers. Ask the kids. Ask those that are around you, that spend time with you. See, I'm going to need some references from you if you want this job. We don't think anything of it in the secular world. Is he trustworthy? Is he sincere? Is he honest? Are you? To be an overseer is a noble task. It requires a noble person. The life must match the doctrine. You can't just preach it. You got to live it. There are others that will observe your spiritual maturity. Here's your next slide. Spiritual maturity should be seen by those inside the fellowship, inside the church, as well as those outside the fellowship or outside the church. I would think the church would be the easiest place to demonstrate spiritual maturity, but some of the most immature, childish people I have ever met are in the church. Anybody else? Nah, you don't want to admit to that. But remember, you're in church, can't lie. Listen now. In my spiritual immaturity, I thought all Christians would be nice. I thought all Christians would be kind to one another. I thought all Christians would be loving and rational. I thought all Christians would be merciful and grace-filled towards one another. In my spiritual immaturity, I thought this. I have since matured. Anybody else? See, we're just like a family. How's your family? How's that dynamic going? How's that functioning? What does that feel like? What does that sense? You know the real issue? The truth? People. It's because we're all people. Well, you're people, whether you're in the church or you're outside the church. You're people, whether you're a believer or not a believer. You're people. It's always been about the people. It's a fellowship of people. Anybody not people in here? Can I see? Okay. So make sure I'm preaching to the right crowd. Aliens of this world, but yet still people. See, I don't apologize even for striving towards that which is ideal, for the highest of standards. But this is the ideal. It's like the Ten Commandments that is placed before you. The ideal. You can't get there. That's the whole point of it being there. See, if you deal only in the idealistic, then you don't deal with the reality. Many within church leadership need to be reminded of certain things. Some of those things are, you know, manners are important. Politeness matters. Managing yourself and your time makes a statement about who you are. Your abilities, or their lack of, Or what is your priority? Church on a Sunday or a basketball game? It says a lot about you. In morality is a biblical standard, not a worldly standard. Morality is a biblical standard. I think that all of this would evidence itself in your life, whether you desire to be in church leadership or not. Whether you would walk alongside somebody like a Timothy, or whether you'd walk alongside someone like me. All these things should be evident in your life, period. Just as a believer, done statement. So often, though, I see people, they get angry. They get upset. You know, even within the church, they just get angry and upset. Somebody offends their feelings. Their feelings get stepped on and hurt. The pastor disappoints us. Just hang around me long enough. I promise you, I'll probably disappoint you somewhere along the line. Why? He didn't preach long enough. Oh, he preached too long. Oh, the sanctuary was too hot. It was too cold. You know, the praise team, they didn't play any songs I like today. Nobody recognized I even had a new shirt on today. Leadership didn't take my advice about what color to paint the prayer room. Nobody called me when I was sick. I missed 3 Sundays. Pastor didn't even say hi to me today. Wow. Wow, that's all reality, folks. Strong leaders for the cause, for the church, cannot allow these types of things to derail them, to cause bad attitude. Somebody else has a bad attitude, therefore I have permission to have a bad attitude. No, sorry. One good sin does not deserve another. And the reality also is that those that do not lead, they have no idea what it is to take the point in a formation. They just don't. They have no idea. They have no idea of the fear, the anxiousness. They have no idea of the responsibility that is placed on the person taking the point. And I relate that to my military experience. When you take the point, oh, you're responsible for all those behind you, right? Am I leading them into disaster? Am I leading them over a cliff? Am I leading them into an ambush? Listen. Even about our military, listen, this kind of gets it to you. If you can't stand behind your military and support them, perhaps you prefer to stand in front of them. If you can't get behind your church leadership, pray for them and support them, perhaps you'd prefer to start your own church and be responsible to God for that. See, those that are out front, you can see why the stressing of this. They need some good character traits. Those that are out front need some good character traits. Listen carefully. Not to just lead, to survive. Not to just lead, to survive at all the stuff that's coming at them. You know those people, they are taking the point, they're just people. They're just people. Pastors, elders, deacons, deaconesses, trustees, treasurers, bookkeepers, praise team, youth group leaders, children, they're just people. They're just people trying to honor and serve the Lord. Missionaries overseas, risking it all in many places, they're just people. Church planters, they're just people. Evangelists, prophets, just people. People that are called to serve. People that desire a noble task, to be an overseer, to be involved in God's kingdom, to be involved in the movement of the Holy Spirit upon the planet Earth, to be the advancement of the good news of Jesus Christ. Some of the strongest traits that people are serving within the church, they need this. It's your next one. They'll need commitment. They will need commitment. I should say to the faithful and to the lost. To the faithful and to the lost. Commitment to the faithful and commitment to the lost. So, listen. The commitment that is required, now listen to what I'm saying to you, is not the commitment to the Lord. It's not that commitment. A person of character would have strong commitment to the Lord. and God would begin to work and develop into their character. This is a commitment. This is a commitment to the people of God or to the lost, to people. It's a commitment to people. You follow me? It's not a commitment to the Lord I'm talking about. It's a commitment to the people that God is asking you to serve. Jesus had a strong commitment to the Father to serve people. Do you want to be Christ-like? He served God by serving people. A commitment to the faithful followers, to those that would believe in him and follow after him and claim his name. To work diligently to bring peace and unity and harmony amongst the people. To bring the word of God. To bring the truth. I want to make sure we got it. Because are you saying then, Pastor, that I need to commit to those people? You mean the one that just had a tantrum because we didn't play the right song today? Yeah. Yeah, you got to commit to those people. You mean the one that was all upset because I didn't say hello to them today? Yeah. Yeah, you got to commit to that. You got to commit to those people. Those people. Yeah. You mean the one that, you know, that shows up every week and just judges me and criticizes me and takes the Facebook? Yep, that person. You got to commit to that. You mean the ones that are irrational? And yeah, you got to commit to those people. The ones that are upset cuz I didn't notice they had a new shirt on today? Yeah, you have to commit to them. Commit to those people. Commit to the faithful people. Commit to the ones that keep showing up and stirring it up. Yeah, those people. Certainly, Pastor, you must not mean the untrustworthy ones, because I know a lot of people in the church, they're untrustworthy. You mean I got to commit to those kind of people? Yeah, exactly. Yep, I sure do. Jesus gave communion to Judas. I have to serve the young? Yeah. The spiritually unhealthy? That's what the church is for. Let's get healthy. Serve them. Yes. You mean people within the church? Yeah. The church people are mean. Yeah. Commit to those people. And everyone the Lord would bring. Then we know this one. Commit to reaching the lost. The lost, the God hater, the kind that would never, you know, cross the threshold of a church door. The ones that don't vote like you, they don't think like you, they don't dress like you. You want me to commit to those people? Yeah. Yep. People. How about we just commit to people? That we're just going to dog them, we're just going to love them. Those people. We're going to pray for those people. Commit to serve with generosity. Be generous with your time. Be generous with your benevolence. Be generous with your help. So, as a fellowship of believers here, what do you think about this? We would commit that every man and woman and child would be given repeated opportunities to hear the message of Jesus Christ. What do you think about that? We would commit that every man, woman, and child would be given repeated opportunities to hear the message, good news of Jesus Christ. All right, now listen. Without them having to do anything or go anywhere. Without them having to do anything or go anywhere. We would commit that every man, woman, and child should have repeated opportunities to hear about the good news of Jesus Christ. And they don't have to do anything or go anywhere. That's the church. That's the church. That's go, make disciples. Go, spread the good news. Be the hands and feet of Christ. Be Christ-like. Serve people. Developing character and commitment is hard work. And not everyone's going to do it. They're just not going to do it. It's hard work. They're not going to do it. They'll get lazy. They just want to show up on Sunday. They exercise their own faith, and that's where it ends. It ends with them. I'm telling you, your faith's much bigger than you. You were saved not just for you, but for something bigger than you. God wants to do something in you, and he's doing it. But he wants to do something through you. Is he doing it? We get kicked in the gut all the time. Yeah, but we battle back and we claim the victory that is ours. We're ready to fight and ready to fight on. Why? Because we're stronger. Our battle is not with flesh and blood. It is against the dark forces of an evil world that wants to take away the truth of Jesus Christ. Do we not see that, church? Do you not see that, Christian? Do you not see that, believer of Jesus Christ? Elders, fight on. Pastors, fight on. Apostles, fight on. Deacons, fight on. Deaconesses, fight on. Trustees, fight on. Ladies groups, keep praying. Pray with diligence. Men's groups, gather. Gather and invite others. Fight on. Youth group, fight on. Take the lead. Step forward. We're waging a war. We're waging a war. And not with each other. It's not about waging a war with each other. It's about waging war against gossip. It's about waging war against jealousy, drunkenness, slander. Fight on. Waging war against laziness, evil, the destructions of your character, the temptations that impede your mind and make you veer off track. Wage war. Encourage others along the way. If you desire to serve in the church, this is a noble, high calling that God has regarded as honorable. There are many blessings in store for you. But you can't get away from your commitment to the people. Whether you take a title in a church format in a nonprofit organizational structure is beside the point. You are a believer and a disciple of God. You're the hands and feet of Christ. You're the church wherever you go. What are you waiting for? What are you waiting for? When I get a little older and a little more mature, what are you waiting for? Is your character under suspicion? What are you waiting for? You don't think you qualify? I don't think I qualify. Do you understand? I don't think I qualify. What gives me this privilege to speak? What makes me so unique? Every week it's a drudge coming before the Lord saying, Lord, help me do this. I can't do this. I'm not worthy to do this. I'm not even supposed to think I can do this. I don't know how to do this. I have to yield myself all over to Christ because I'm not worthy. But then something happens. Then Jesus. Then something happens. Then the Holy Spirit. Then Jesus. Then Jesus picks me up off the floor of my own regret and my own self-loathing and says, come, child, get in the pulpit and preach the word. See, Jesus makes me something. Jesus makes you something. Then Jesus. And Jesus lifts me up out of the mire. He promotes me. And he prompts me. And he says, go. Go. Go speak. Go preach. Go teach. Go talk. Don't let fear stop you. It's Christ that gives you the confidence. It's Christ that will bring the truth before you. It's the zeal for his kingdom of God. Get up. Speak. Get up and preach. Get up and fight. Have no fear. I am with you. And there'll be moments, just like right now, today, you will need to be still and know that I am God. Let's just put it out there, folks. I'm not worthy. I'm not worthy to be up here. Let's just put it out there, folks. You're not worthy. You're not worthy. You're not worthy of his presence. Not one of us is. We've all fallen short of the glory of God. But then Jesus. Somebody say, but then Jesus. But then Jesus. But then Jesus. But then Spirit became flesh. Spirit of God would dwell within the believer. But then Jesus. But then the Holy Spirit of God makes us worthy. Made me worthy. Makes you worthy. Cleanses you, rebuilds you, restructures you, changes you, fills you, and empowers you that you can accomplish and become an overcomer. Even of your own thoughts, even of your own self, he will help you overcome to be more than a conqueror. That's the Jesus I know. That's the Jesus I speak of. Don't look at me. I'm just following Christ, but come along if you want. Let's look to Jesus together. Therein lies the power. Character is not developed overnight. It takes time. And this is why leaders shouldn't be recent converts. There's the testing. There's the testing. I had to grow up out of my spiritual immaturity to grow into spiritual maturity that I could understand what it is to look and think and act immature. And I've fallen into that kind of leadership stuff before too, where I've appointed people way before they're supposed to be in any kind of position. Why would you even do such a thing, Pastor? Well, what's a successful church look like? Well, a successful church has elders, so we need to appoint some elders. A successful church has trustees, so we need to appoint some trustees. And a successful looking church has deaconesses and deacons and children's church president. And a successful church has all of this stuff. So you're the children's church president, you're the elder, you're the president. And you create a mess. An absolute mess. Been there, done that. Grown out of my immaturity. The testing that is required. Can't be a recent convert. The testing that is required. I would leave a position empty before I fill it with the wrong person. Competency, here's your last one. Competence. To be competent in their ability to discern Scripture, to present the gospel and the knowledge of Jesus Christ. Paul tells Timothy concerning this. And don't let others look down upon you because you're young. You're very mature, but you're young. Competent in your ability. Spiritual leadership development, I've been about this since I've even began in ministry. This is what we do, even as a church. We develop. We work. We make disciples. We mature believers. We multiply ministries. That's what we do over and over and over again. That's all I think in my head. That's all I know. Make disciples, mature believers, multiply ministries. It's pretty boring, really. That's all we do, over and over and over and over again. I can't say it's really boring because it involves people, and people are never boring. People are crazy. God is great, beer's good, and people are crazy. You heard that song? Go home and listen to it if you haven't. Spiritual maturity takes time. It takes growth. How do we grow in our spiritual maturity, and how do we grow into spiritual leadership? Well, we're going to have a sincere desire for God's word and to know this Jesus that I'm talking about. We truly desire to pray and to walk with Christ in your private life and in your public life, and may I even suggest in your secret life. He knows about it. As we desire, the Holy Spirit begins working on us daily, chipping away from all those rough edges. Anybody still got rough edges? I still got some rough edges, right? Still working on trying to polish us up, right? And removing that which does not exalt Jesus Christ. As we grow and mature, our families will notice, but also fellow believers. So will our neighbors. Remember, leadership in the church is spiritual maturity that others can examine and follow. That others can examine and follow, should anyone follow you. The teaching must match the preaching. The talking must match the walking, right? Because this is the reality now. Here's your last slide. Demonstration has eclipsed proclamation. Your actions will speak louder than your words. There's the test. I pray the Lord raises you up into maturity. I pray the Holy Spirit inspires you to be all that God desires you to be for Him and for His church. I pray that you become competent in your ability to express your faith, your ability to teach, your ability to witness, your ability to lead others, and your ability to understand who this Christ is in your life. Don't hesitate. Step forward. Heed the call that God is leading you to. Let me pray for you. Father, in this place, we exalt you, we praised you, we sang to you, danced before you, uplifted our hearts, prayed for others. Father, we're your family, we're your children. Messed up as we are, you love us. And so, Father, I would pray that by your Holy Spirit, you would unite us together, that we would serve you and serve you well. Father, that you would challenge us in our ways of thinking. Challenge us, Father, that we might become more Christ-like. Chip away the rough edges. Chip away that which is a misunderstanding about who you are. Reveal yourself in a very new, vibrant, and truthful way. We desire you, Lord. We hunger for you in our lives. I don't want to know about you. I want to know you. In this place, sanctified, holy ground, set apart for you and your good works, may it continue. May it continue to bring you honor, glory, and praise that you so richly deserve. We come before you, Father, humbleness in our hearts, declaring Jesus as our Savior, our sanctifier, our healer, our coming King. In His name, we pray. Amen. One of the things that ends up happening at service ending is this family ends up hanging out for like a half an hour, 45 minutes, and I'm just hanging out, talking to each other, praying for each other. It's great. I go back there and just want to say goodbye to people that are leaving, but I'm hanging around waiting and waiting and waiting, and there's people up here praying. There's people over here catching up with each other, haven't seen in a while. It's wonderful to be a part of a family that knows how to rock the house together, a family that knows how to be quiet together. And a church that knows how to stand up together. Stand up, please stand. For this reason, I remind you to fan into flame the gift of God, which is in you through the laying on of hands. For the Spirit of God gave us, the Spirit of God that has been given to us does not make us timid, but gives us power, love, and self-discipline. So do not be ashamed of your testimony about our Lord. Rather, join with me in the suffering of the gospel by the power of God. He has saved us and called us into a holy life, not because of anything that we have done, but because of his own purpose and grace. May the Lord fill you with his purpose for you. May he fill you with grace to accomplish all that he has laid out before you. In the name of your son, his son, amen. God bless you. Go serve your God.